हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू लेक्चर नंबर 2 ऑफ यूनिट नंबर 6 एंड द नेम ऑफ यूनिट नंबर 6 इज प्लास्टिक एनालिसिस ऑफ स्ट्रक्चर्स. इन दिस यूनिट वी हैव ऑलरेडी कवर्ड वन लेक्चर एंड इन दैट वी स्टडीड व्हाट इज़ द प्लास्टिक एनालिसिस एंड नेक्स्ट वी कवर्ड वन टॉपिक विच इज़ स्ट्रेस स्ट्रेन कर्व ऑफ माइल्ड स्टील. After that, in the last part of previous lecture, I said I'll cover idealized curve. What is idealized stress strain curve and how it is developed. So first topic of today's lecture is idealized stress strain curve. Next is assumptions in plastic analysis. And third one is the stress distribution in elastoplastic and plastic stage. So step by step we will understand all these three topics. So first let's start our first topic, which is idealized stress strain curve. In the corner I have mentioned you a stress strain curve of mild steel. You can see over here it is a stress strain curve of mild steel. We know already in the mild steel, when a experiment is conducted on a mild steel, we get stress strain curve like this, as I mentioned in this corner. In that, first O to A region is an elastic region. From before this O to A, or exactly talking about this O to A, even in this region, we have one another point other than A, that is a point where we call a limit of proportionality exist. At this point, Hooke's law, up to this point Hooke's law is valid and stress is directly proportional to strain. But after the limit of proportionality, when we reach towards the A point from this region, so in this region Hooke's law is not valid and plastic lethal deformation or lethal curvature in the graph is visible, and then we reach to the elastic point or limit of elastic point. Understood? Then elastic limit, what we called it. Then we go towards upper yield point, which is at B. Then lower yield point, upper yield point is at B, lower yield point is at C. And magnitude, I said in the previous lecture only, the point A, which is called as a elastic limit, that point and B is almost coincide. You can differentiate over here, the A is different point and B is different, but it is almost coincide. The value between these two points is very less. Then come to the C point. C point is, I said, it's the lower yield point, and we never take upper yield point value for designing any structure. We always go for the Fy, which is mentioned over here, which is actually taken from the lower yield point. Why? Because lower yield point is the stable point, whereas upper yield point is the instable point. We can't go for the instable value of a load to develop, or a stress to develop our further procedure or go for the designing. Therefore we always take a load or yielding stress from the lower yield point. Then from C to D, I said it is a plastic region. It's a plastic region in which a permanent deformation has already happened, which we can't remove. This point shows us a permanent deformation of magnitude 0.02, or I say 0.2% strain is still set. It is in the rod available. It is in the rod, and we can't remove that. We can't say that body will regain its original shape and size. So there is certain amount of strain which is exist in our material, and then from this C region plastic range will start, and that will be from C to D. So this is the few parameters and basic points about mild steel stress strain graph, which we already stood in the descriptive way, already studied in the last lecture. Now come to the idealized stress strain curve. In the idealized stress strain curve, you can see I have drawn 1, 2 and 3 different diagrams over here. So one can conceive this curve for mild steel in the simplest way as in this three forms. What these three forms are about? So see, in the first form here, x-axis again it is strain, on the y-axis we mention stress, okay, and the graph is showing us a horizontal line, only a single horizontal line. This single horizontal line tell us that up to certain magnitude of stress, from this to this region, there is no strain because strain in this region is zero, right? After taking one possible highest magnitude, that material shown us strain. After certain value of a stress, that material shown us a strain or started deforming. You can apply this graph for a concrete. Concrete will take a stress up to certain possible highest value and then it will start deforming. Okay, so this type of graph is called as a fully plastic graph. Then we will go to the second case. In the second case, you can see that curve is showing us an inclined line first and then horizontal line. In the first inclined line, you can say that there is certain linear pattern followed by a graph. What that linear pattern is? That linear pattern tells us that stress is directly proportional to strain. Stress is directly proportional to strain. And in this region, we can say that this region is exactly same as the mild steel stress strain graph. There is a linear proportion between stress and strain, and after a certain magnitude of stress, it is shown horizontal line, which means a plastic behavior. This region of our curve is already said as a plastic region, exactly the way here we got a horizontal line, that giving us a plastic behavior. Therefore this graph is called as a linearly elastic. This is the region in which we can say it is linearly elastic. In this region, we can say it is fully plastic, as shown here in the first graph, fully plastic. Now, in the next region, in the next graph, you can see the graph showing us a linear as well as some inclined region in the plastic, where we expecting plastic range, there it is again showing us a linear variation. Okay, so first is we know it is linearly elastic. In the second region, it is linearly plastic. It is not fully plastic. How it is? It is linearly plastic. Slowly with linear behavior, it is showing us a plastic. Then next, in the next graph, what I want to tell you, out of this three graph, how we develop this three graph, before the, going for next topic, we will learn or we will understood, we will try to understand that how this graph is developed. In the first graph, I have removed this inclination or linear proportion of our graph, and then I took a only plastic region of our MS stress strain curve. Okay, in the second graph, I have taken, for the second case, I have taken inclination as well as plastic behavior of a MS stress strain graph. In the second region, I have taken, you can see that this line is not horizontal. This line is supposed to go horizontal, but it is not exactly horizontal. It shows a certain inclination. I have taken that linear behavior as well. I have taken a linear behavior in the elastic region and then took a lateral inclination or a linear behavior in plastic range, and I combine that and come to the case number 3. Now, which case is called as an ideal stress strength curve and which case we are considering for plastic analysis? That's the next point. So see, we are taking this purely for concrete, but plastic analysis is for steel structures. Plastic analysis for steel structure, because we want to utilize maximum strength of a steel, and maximum strength is added to the steel because of the extra properties like tensity and ductility. So we, as I said, this is purely a concrete phenomena, and I will not use that graph for idealization. I'll go for, if I choose this, yes, it is giving a elastic as well as plastic behavior, we can use it. In the next graph, this is reserved for some another analysis. So the only option with which we can go further is linear elastic and fully plastic graph. Linearly elastic and fully plastic graph. You can see it is linear in the elastic region and fully plastic behavior in the plastic region. It is showing strain and stress graph. That's what we called it as a idealized graph for stress strain analysis this is the idealized graph which we gonna use in the plastic analysis. Now let's understand few more concept about this idealized graph. What this idealized graph is, so see, in the plastic analysis, the elastic limit and lower yield point, where this points are, so you can see in this graph the elastic limit is here, right, and lower yield point is at C, may be assumed to be numerically identical. They are considered as a numerically identical. Okay, so magnitude at elastic point and at lower yield point are magnitudely or numerical value is identical. Now next point is, because of large reserve strength in mild steel plastic range is to extend it without, what they said in the first half, they said because of large reserve strength in the mild steel, as I already said, it is the extra properties which we have with the steel, tensity and ductility, which adds a extra strength to the steel. In the plastic region, that strength is reserved, and therefore we are extending plastic range, extending it without a limit by neglecting what? By neglecting effect of strain hardening. So where does the strain hardening region is? So strain hardening region, it start from here to here, it is strain hardening region, and here to here is a strain softening region. We neglected this part and we extended the plastic range limitlessly because of the extra strength reserved in the plastic range, and we want to utilize it. Therefore, the next curvature is neglected and we increase the plastic range in the idealized curve. Understood? That's what the phenomenon behind the idealized curve of plastic analysis. Now let's go to the next point, which is assumptions in plastic analysis. The first assumption in this topic is plane section, which we can read as plane section remain plane before and after bending up to the collapse. What I said, a plane section remain plane before and after the bending, and it is remain plane up to the collapse. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that strain diagram is linear up to the collapse. So you must be remember, we have a beam with us. Let's suppose we have a beam with us, a simply supported beam. And when we apply a load on it, it will show us a sagging bending moment. Okay, so it is bent down. We can say it is a bend after bending. And this beam is before bending. Before bending. Okay, and what this assumption says, even before and after bending, plane section a plain section remains plain. So I have taken a one cross section out of this beam. If the beam is like this, okay, if your beam is like this, and if I cut over here, I will get this cross section, right? And this cross section I have drawn over here. I have drawn over here. In this cross section, this is the cross section of beam, simply supported beam. And I have drawn, this diagram is nothing but the strain diagram. It is strain diagram. What it is showing? It is showing us a variation of strain, in compression and tension region. So why I have wrote compression in upper side? Because see, it bends like this. Your simply supported beam bends like this. All upper fibers are in compression. All bottom fibers are experiencing tension, right? And compression is on top fiber. Therefore, in the strain diagram, I said compression is in upper fiber or upper region and tension is in lower region. When you load a beam, it will show us a bending. This is your simply supported beam. This is the elevation of that beam and it is showing us after bending. And I am saying the strain variation, and I am showing here a strain variation. And this strain variation before bending and even after bending remains same. Okay, this is the strain diagram for before bending and this is the strain diagram of after bending. It means that this section will not get any strain, any bending will not, even after bending it will not show any plane or any variation. See here, what is our statement? Plain section remain plain. So this cross section is not supposed to bend down or show variation its shape or deformation. It will get deformed, but it will show a linear behavior of strain. Strain is nothing but deformation per original. Strain is what? Change in original dimension, change in original dimension to the original dimension, right? That is what strain, and the strain is linear. Strain is linear. Understood? That's what the meaning of this statement. Now let's move towards the next assumption. In the next assumption, it is said, vertical load is assumed to act through the shear center. Now what is shear center? You must have heard about in the SOM. You have gone through this shear center concept. In the SOM we understood, if there is a channel section and if we want to apply a force on it, if we apply it like this, it will suffer under twisting moment. It will experience a twisting moment. But if we don't want to experience this channel twisting moment, or if we want to avoid twisting moment in this channel, we have to pass a vertical load from its shear center. And where does the shear center lies in channel section? It lies here outside the channel section on left hand side. If you pass the vertical load from this point, this channel section will not suffer any twisting moment. And that's what I said in here. The vertical load is assumed to pass through the shear center so that our cross section will not experience any twisting moment, and twisting moment is zero. Then the third assumption is that the effect of axial force and shear force is neglected in plastic analysis. What does it mean? It means that
Even if there is an axial force, we assume that axial deformation, and even after there is a shear force, the shear deformation is not considered. See, we assuming though there is an axial force, though there is a shear force, we are not going to consider shear deformation and axial deformation. Now, next assumption in this is, the stress strain diagram is assumed to idealize to two straight lines. Which are those two straight lines? One linear, one horizontal straight line. And strain hardening effect. Where is the strain hardening effect? Next curvature of our MS steel strain strain graph, right? That strain hardening region is neglected. And we idealized our curve. In the linear and plastic zone only, and we extended plastic region limitlessly and idealized our curve, and we are using this curve for our plastic analysis. Next assumption is, relationship between compressive stress and compressive strain is same as between tensile stress and tensile strain. So see over here, whatever curve you consider for compression, that exact same curve you consider for tension. So how stress, even in the compression region stress is directly proportional to strain, then in the tension region also stress is directly proportional to strain. So whatever relationship is exist between compressive stress and compressive strain, exact same relation is exist between tensile stress and tensile strain. Now, the very last topic of our today's lecture is stress distribution. Is about stress distribution in elastic, elastoplastic and plastic stages. So what are the stages? Let's assume one simply supported beam again with us. This is simply supported at its end supports, and we have considered a cross section of it as a rectangular shape over here. The total depth of this beam is small d, and if I draw a neutral axis in the cross section, it will divide our rectangular beam into two halves, d by 2 and d by 2 heights, or a depth of those two different halves. Now, if we apply a loading on this beam at this point, if I apply a W load at this point, it will show us a deformation. It will start showing us a deformation. But if until our working stress is less than the yield stress. What is yield stress? Yield stress is a, let's check in the stress strain graph. A yield stress is a stress at a elastic limit. Up to the elastic limit, stress is directly proportional to stresses. Stress strain variation is a linear, though up to the proportionality limit, even Hooke's law is valid. So same region, same yielding point we have on our idealized curve over here. Understood? And if our working stress FB is in this region, then our graph will be like this. Understood? That's the graph, or that's the strain diagram for our simply supported beam. Now, if we start to increasing working stress on our beam, if W value is now getting increased, and if it is equals to yielding stress, the diagram may show the maximum strain more than the diagram shown in the previous case, where the stress, working stress, is less than the yielding point. Understood? But diagram will be in a linear variation. Still, the variation is linear. Linearly, it means that stress is almost
proportional to strain. Stress is directly proportional to strain. How much is the stress, that much will be the strain developed into the beam. Now, when F or a working stress becomes equals to yield stress, who will experience the maximum stress in the cross section? The extreme fibers will get working stress equals to yielding stress. They will experience first a maximum stress, where other layers or other fibers inside this cross section or inside this beam are not experiences a working stress equals to Fy. They are experiencing it much lesser than the yielding stress. They are experiencing much less than the yielding stress. Therefore, once the extreme fibers experienced a maximum stress, working stress equals to yielding stress, they will start transforming that stress to the lower fibers. They will start transforming it to the lower fibers. And now lower fibers will experience working stress is equals to yield stress. Therefore, somewhere in between, while it is transforming or penetrating down, we will get a diagram like this. All the extreme fibers are already experienced Fy stress or yielding stress, and all the adjacent fibers in this region are start experiencing yielding stress, whereas this rest of the particles, this members or a layers or a fibers are not experienced higher stress. They will experience once the all fibers from top and bottom side, from compression and tension side, experience maximum stress equals to yielding stress, the diagram becomes like this. At top it is Fy, at bottom it is Fy, even at the extreme fiber it is Fy, at the neutral axis it is Fy. That is what we call fully plastic range. Whereas in this case only the extreme fibers are experiencing yielding stress, where in the second case all the internal fibers also experiencing stress equals to Fy. That's the difference between elastic range and plastic range of our curve. Here we understood how the stress distribution takes place in the elastic, elastoplastic and plastic stages. In the next lecture, here our topics which I want to cover in this lecture is ends over here. In the next lecture, we will understand and we will learn what is plastic moment. Thank you.